ships from the past hold on to their secrets, and this had been true of the Starship Enterprise, until now. Treasures that have risen to the surface are these remarkably candid scenes from Starfleet Life, filmed on set by Enterprise crewman, actor Billy Blackburn.
My character was Lieutenant Hadley, and I kept my mouth shut at the bridge for 3 years after being told by the assistant director, just sit there. And I did. But I also did a lot of the other characters, too. I took my camera on the set, and the first time I took it, nobody said anything. Everybody, the cameraman was looking at me, taking it, and Bill was saw me do it. So then I always had it with me. Leonard would give me the sign, and Bill would perform for me. And he was always upstaging DeForest, I mean deliberately for the camera. I think there's one segment there, shooting the whole bit, and finally Leonard looks up and he goes, "Get out of the shot, Billy. Get out of the shot." And of course it was for fun, you know.
And no matter on which planet they were filming, Bill Shatner would always be accompanied by his beloved dog.
Bill always had these wonderful Dobermans, and he often had them in his dressing room. Yeah. I enjoyed them. They were great. Never attacked me.
I had never seen Morgan before, and that was his name. Beautiful Doberman. In the sequence, Morgan actually goes and circles the set when Bill was on it by the pylon. The dog is in the background, and he kept circling and circling.
Dobermans can be very protective of the master. He would threaten you with the dogs, you know. Look out, Sterling would get you. Look out.
But it wasn't the dogs who were after Mr. Spock. He found himself becoming something of a pointy-eared sex symbol.
Until now, there was always a place in here where no one could come.
I was pleasantly surprised by it. I thought, that's interesting. Being me, male and inside the character, I didn't quite get it. I don't quite understand it. I began to give it some thought, and at least logically, I began to hear and see certain clues.
I'm in love with you, Mr. Spock.
And there was something for a woman to want to be nurturing with Spock. I understood that.
Now tell me, did she happen to make any comment about those ears?
And she found them the most attractive human characteristic of all.
He could wield much more emotion out of a raised eyebrow at the proper time than a two-page speech.
I don't know if Bill's going to say he was upset, but the Mr. Spock character became so important. I would get phone calls from Life magazine, from this magazine, from that magazine, saying, "We'd like to come to the set. We want to do something with Mr. Nimoy, etc., etc." We kind of try to keep that down some because Bill was the star of the show, and the second banana is getting all the attention.
There must have been some rivalry. Must have been. Anyway, it makes good copy that there was.
I never thought of myself as anything other than a supporting actor, working equally as hard as Bill Shatner, not being paid as well, by the way, and wanting as much success as he did. I was competitive, I was ambitious, but I never misunderstood what role I was playing.
And I keep trying to remember whether I felt envy, and all I can remember is feeling a momentary, you know, days or weeks of anxiety about the popularity of Spock. But I don't remember, being hysterical about it.
Jim!
My recollection of those days was camaraderie.
I'm pleased to see you, Captain.
And then, over the years, the friendship, the fondness and the love between Leonard Nimoy and myself is I can't remember when it wasn't.
For both Bill Shatner and Leonard Nimoy, turning round a Star Trek episode in 6 or 7 filming days, week on week, meant for a punishing work schedule.
I was very disciplined, and I always saw to it that I got enough sleep. Head down on the pillow at 9:30 at night, out. And up the next morning at 5:30, I need 8 hours sleep, or I did then when I was working. I could get up at 5:30 in the morning and be at work at 6:30. If I caught a cup of coffee on the way out the door, and I could get to the studio by 6:30. And then I'd have some breakfast as I'm sitting in the chair. They'd bring me breakfast. And it wasn't just the ears. The eyebrows were very time-consuming because they laid on hair by hair each morning. And then the rest of the makeup. It was an hour and a half. And I could learn lines during that period of time. I could study my script.
Sometimes the pages would come down late, and we'd be getting pages to a scene we didn't know the script to. So you had to play everything. So you didn't know what your character was or how I felt about you or what you felt about me. So you might as well play hate and love. I hate you and I love you. So maybe it's a little anxiety, but I don't care. Because you play everything.
I, Captain Kirk!
If Kirk and Spock were feeling the pressure, other crew members were also sending out distress signals. Concerned about her lack of lines and meaningful action, at the end of season one, Lieutenant Uhura was ready to desert her post.
Since it wasn't going to be this marvelous role that I expected it to be, the scenes were constantly cut.
Mr. Spock, sometimes I think if I hear that word frequency once more, I'll cry.
My focus was not being upset about that, but going, oh, okay, that's the way the industry, this industry is. So by the end of the first season, I felt no compunction about leaving.
But before she could jump ship, Nichelle changed her mind following a close encounter with a very special fan.
I was told that there was someone who wanted to meet me, and I thought it was a fan. And I turned and looked in the face of Dr. Martin Luther King. And he smiled with that marvelous face and said, yes, I am the avid fan. And he convinced me that I absolutely could not leave the show. I had a responsibility. He was out there working on civil rights so that I could be and people like me could be on that television.
Why don't you tell me I'm an attractive young lady? Or ask me if I've ever been in love?
It was very, very current, very much in touch with the zeitgeist, what's going on in the world.
Where I come from, size, shape, or color makes no difference.
Vietnam was going on, Martin Luther King was going on, the civil rights movements and so forth, all happening all around us, and I was very much in tune with it.
Star Trek may have been boldly going where no TV series had gone before, but sadly it was not a hit. Ratings were low, and at the end of the second series, the show received the Vulcan death grip.
It was a small, loyal audience. I think we attracted, averaged around 5 million viewers. Now, 5 million fans or viewers may seem like a lot, but in television terms back then, it wasn't.
Faced with the loss of their favorite series, enraged fans got their own communication lines open, setting up a massive chain letter campaign.
There was something like 110,000 letters came in a 4 or 5 week period. They were really inundated. There was some successful chain letter networking was done. People put out word and said to 10 people, you put talk to 10 people. And the audience that we had was not large, but it was intense and vocal.
I had a friend of mine, an executive at NBC, who went to his car in the NBC secured parking lot, and someone had written on his car, don't cancel Star Trek. I mean, if he came, I mean, the CIA should be as good as these guys were.
NBC, on air, at the end of one of the episodes, announced that Star Trek would be back the following season, and the legend was they did that to stop the mail from coming. So I guess it worked.
So the Enterprise was salvaged for another voyage, but was she still a happy ship?
Don't you want to hear, she said, how much we all hated you?